All right.
Oh, there we go. Hey, everybody. How's
Good
it going?
Good evening.
Good evening. Tonight we are...
Hi.
We're joined by Kelsey Lewin, who we met for the first time at Missouri Game Con, much like Reggie, who joined us last week.
Yeah, so we've got like a Missouri reunion going on these past two streams.
Yep.
Also, You've got the little mini thing on the hanging over the Skype window, Corey.
I got what thing hanging over the Skype window?
There's like double Skype image going on. The little mini image is hanging
out
there.
I see. I don't know if I can do anything about that. There we go. That might help. Let's try that. All right.
Did the bird fly away?
He's on my knee now.
Oh, maybe he'll come back.
Yeah.
I had no idea that you had a bird.
Yeah. Yeah, he's a green cheek conure. They're assholes, but they're cute. So.
you just let him fly around your house.
Yeah, he's pretty like, he knows not to poop on people. I mean, birds do poop, so I do have to clean it up off the floor sometimes,
Does he know to not poop on game shelves?
Yes. Yeah, he's honestly, I don't think he's ever really pooped on something that wasn't like a floor or a counter. He pooped on my like laundry one time, but other than that, he's pretty good.
Don't poop on people. Don't poop on games. That's all you need to know.
Yeah, or laundry, preferably not laundry.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
I always go back to your cage if you got to poop. So I asked Kelsey last night, "What do you want me to play?" And she's like, "Oh, you should play Odin Sphere, because you're a big fan of it." You played it on the Vita, right?
Yeah. Yeah, this is one of my favorite games, like, ever. And I played it. I didn't know it was one of my favorite games ever until I went and replayed it on the Vita when it came out. I played it for the first time on the PS2, like, and I don't know, maybe 2 years after it came out, but I never finished it. I think I was borrowing it from a friend, if I remember correctly, but it was a long time ago. And I remember it being fun, so when this one came out, I was like, ooh, I'm going to try that again. And it's awesome. It's so much fun. It's just like... You know, I play a lot of RPGs, and while this one is, like, technically an RPG, it's a lot heavier on the action, and, like, it's almost more like beat-em-up a little bit than it is
an
RPG.
Yeah, a lot of combos like, and stuff.
With RPG elements.
Yeah, I remember when I played through the PS2 version, and I intend to get the PS4 version, but I don't have it yet. But I remember there's, like, this little mini-map. They're like sort of like each area is kind of a circle and
right.
It loops. And there's like a little, screen like in the, like a mini map that shows like the outlines of like the characters that are running around the field. And I remember like a lot of times I was like playing, looking at that wee teeny tiny screen more than I was actually looking at like the playing field. I don't know if the HD version sort of changes that dynamic at all. Maybe if it zoomed, I'll be curious to see if it's like kind of zoomed out a little more than the PS2 version is.
Yeah. I mean, since we don't usually play RPG kind of games on stream, I went through and just like kind of did the intro already. So I could kind of get an idea of what the story was about. So, I mean, like, so I don't feel like I'm very lost and I'm not skipping over stuff.
Right.
So I'm going to go ahead and start.
So if I'm remembering right, the way this plays out, like you play through a character's entire story and then you go to the next character, right? It doesn't like skip between characters.
Yeah.
I can't remember.
Yeah, you like, can't. I think you can select characters beforehand. I think you have to go in the order it wants you to go in.
Right, and then I forget how, like, there's, like, one or two sort of last stories. I can't really remember how it plays out exactly.
The rabbit was my least favorite line. I think Gwendolyn, which is what you're playing right now, is probably my favorite one. Like, I think she's got the coolest weapon.
Yeah, I mean, she's definitely the most iconic character in the game. I remember liking the Puka Prince decently well. The one thing I totally forgot about when I was gathering footage for our big PS2 episode. You know, I've got my in-game save, so I was able to like choose any character, and I think I featured every character from this game at some point in that video. And I completely forgot about the Fairy Princess character. It starts with an M, I think.
Oh, yeah, she's cool. I forget her name, too, but she's got the staff that shoots stuff out of it.
Like, it was more like a crossbow, I thought. It was
you're right. It's a crossbow.
It was like machine gun crossbow. I'm like, this is awesome. Why don't I remember this at all? the Black Knight sort of guy, I don't really remember liking him too much. And then there's like the Red Riding Hood sort of looking character.
Yeah, she's cool.
Velvet, I think.
Velvet, that's right. So you remember all these character names, and I don't. I played it not that long ago.
I'm trying to blank on what the Black Knight guy, what his name was.
Me too.
I forget if I remember that like the rabbit guy. His name is I can't remember his actual name, but he like the chapter on the character select just says the Puka Prince.
So yeah,
that's what I always think of. I remember on the PS2 version. So I was like going through this phase of like trading games on like the CAG forums, like kind of around the time that this game came out on PS2, and
like a cheap ass gamer, right?
Cool. Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
And I went through a phase of like doing that for I don't know, maybe a year. It was kind of addictive because I was like, you know, people like had their list of things that were on offer, and you know, I was kind of like, oh, you know, and I remember. I want to say, like, this was right around the time that I got rid of my first PSP, because I was just, like, really annoyed with the system at the time. And obviously, you know, this it came back around, but, you know, and I've got one again. But I really was mad at the PSP at the time. And I just, like, felt like everything that I'd done with it was a waste of money. So I was, like, getting rid of my PSP. And I remember, I think this was when I made this deal. Like, I sold all my PSP stuff to some guy. And I think I got, like, a bunch of stuff I wanted in return. And, like, I really felt like I was definitely getting the better deal. And it may have not been the PSP deal. But regardless, at some point during this time when I was playing Odin Sphere, like, I think I got it the day it came out. Because there was, like, sort of some hype because of, like, there was like a lot of hype about how it's like, whoa, like the 2D animation of this is crazy. Never seen anything like this. which, you know, I mean, it is a very beautiful game, but I feel like if it was released in today's indie environment, when there are like a lot of games with like unique 2D art styles, like maybe it wouldn't have made as much of an impact. But I feel like VanillaWare really released this at the right time to get the reputation that they got, because at the time, we were not seeing games with this sort of really handcrafted 2D art.
Well, but they had done what was it, Princess Crown?
Well, I don't think they were actually VanillaWare at that time. I think, but like,
well, Princess Crown didn't come out here, right?
Right.
Princess Crown was just Japan, so.
Right, and I don't know. I've always been under the impression that it was, like, another company, but then, like, the creative staff from that, like, formed VanillaWare. And so, as far as I know, this is the first title that is officially VanillaWare as a company, but I could be wrong. But, you know, at any rate, like, people just, you know, this was kind of a unusual sort of game to see on a console at the time with this sort of art. And, but anyway, so I say all that to say, around this time, I made some trade where this guy just threw in a PS2 HD loader disc because it was like I've been trying to get rid of this thing for a while. No one wants it. I'm just gonna throw it in your box. And I'm like, okay. And what it is it's a disc that lets you boot, like it's a DVD, but it lets you boot games from the PlayStation 2 hard drive, which I did have a hard drive in my PS2 because I had played Final Fantasy 11, and it was so good for this game because the load times on the PS2 version are ridiculous, and especially in talking about the Puka Prince made remind me of this, the Puka Village. You do this thing where you go to like the cafe. There's like two restaurants that you can go to, I think. Is that right?
Yeah, that's right.
And you like have to choose which one you go to, and I think each one raises like different stats or something like that. Maybe?
Is it that, or is it just that it's different? I thought one was like for dessert type things and one was for like meal type things. But I can't remember now if it raised different things.
Yeah, or it might just depend on the ingredients you have, because I think you have to provide the ingredients, is that right?
The ingredients and the coins.
I remember, like, going inside the two restaurants and, like, going between them, and, like, even in this very small area in the Puka Village, you have to go through all these load screens, and, I mean, it just, like, really ruined, like, I'm not, like, a big load time complainer in general, but, like, in that case, it, like, really was ruining the experience to some extent because it took so long. And so I installed Odin Sphere, the disc, to the hard drive and played the rest of the game off the hard drive, and wow, what a difference that made. That
it's sold,
is the only game. Well, no, that's actually the only game I ever played that way. but it was free, and it hit at the right time to meet my need.
That's, like, the big reason that I don't go back and play PS1 games unless I can download them on, like, my Vita or my PS4. Mm-hmm. Is because I'm spoiled now. Like, I cannot deal with the load times anymore.
It's kind of funny because I feel like we've kind of regressed on load times in modern games in a lot of ways.
That's true, actually.
I almost think it's because, I mean, I don't really know the exact technical reason, but I mean, it's just because I think the amount of data that is being loaded at one time is growing disproportionately to the increased load speeds that we can do, even though now, modern consoles have everything installed to the hard drive. I mean, it's funny to even think, like, 3DS, for example, you would think, oh, cartridges, that should be instant, like it was on, Super Nintendo and all, but they do have load times, I think, just because they're loading more data than they used to, so...
I can already tell that I'm going to love this game. When you go into the menu, it feels like Secret of Mana.
the radial menu.
Yeah.
Have you tried growing anything yet?
Well, I think I will right now. I mean, I've already done it, but I don't have any. I do have one.
I mean, assuming it's like the PS2 version, you kind of have to wait like for things to grow, but...
The seeds you have at the beginning of the game, though, shouldn't take very much time. So, you can plant that.
I want to say, if I remember right, like, so you can, like, release those things and, like, have them feed the plant?
Yeah,
that's how you grow them.
The
mulberry ones don't take very much, whereas the sheep ones take, like, an insane amount.
Yeah, I'm trying to think, like...
If that's new.
I can't remember if in the PS2 version if you could, like, release those sparkly things or if they could only be, like, the ones that were, like, naturally floating around the battlefield. Because those fall out of enemies, like, when you attack them, right?
Yeah.
Because I want to say I remember a lot of the times just, like, planting seeds before the battle really got underway and then just letting the experience that, like, flies around the battlefield just, like, naturally feed the plant, sort of speed up the process before I fought the battle.
I've read that.
Yeah, it seems like a good idea.
I just can't remember if, like, you could, like, release the experience points or whatever they are, like, manually on the PS2 version. I just remember they got really, really hard by the end of the game. Like, the first 2 to 3 character stories probably aren't that hard, but...
You have to get them all to get, like, the actual ending, right?
Right, there's like one, I forget if it's like divided into 1 or 2 books, like the whole ending scenario. But yeah, you like go through 5 character storylines. I've always sort of the first game I think of this that I think I played was like Suikoden 3. I always have kind of liked the idea of like playing is different sides of like a conflict, like over the course of the game, like this game definitely lets you do.
Do you guys play the Fire Emblem Awakening? No, not Awakening. The Conquest? One that's Birthright and Conquest.
Yeah, I've got it. I'm way behind on Fire Emblem right now. I played Awakening, but I've got the like dual pack. Conquest and Birthright.
It's so frustrating, you know, that I didn't even know that existed until, and it's already sold out before.
Oh no. Yeah, that one sold out really quick.
Yeah. I got it pre-ordered. It's both games on one cart.
And the DLC, right?
I'm not sure if the DLC on the cart?
I think so, yeah. It gives you the option at the very least. Hi, Reggie. I noticed you.
Hi, Reggie.
But, yeah. All I meant from that was I really liked... It had been a while since I had played... Well, I guess other than Odin Sphere, a game that had the, like, you know, play two separate sides of the same type thing. I really like that.
But what's sort of nice about this is, like, to just get through the game, like, you have to do both sides just to finish the game. Whereas with something like Fire Emblem Conquest, I feel like by the time I beat whichever path that I choose, I'll probably finish that and I'll end up playing off the other forever. Because it's like, I finished it. I got to the credits.
Yeah, I mean, each side does wrap it up pretty nicely because, I mean, they don't expect everyone to buy both sides. So they wouldn't want to leave it on like a huge cliffhanger that leaves you upset, you know, that like Nintendo's forcing you to buy both copies and spend $80. But I played both just because I really liked it. But I don't think you need to unless you really, really like where it's going and are just curious.
Did you play the third storyline?
I didn't. No. I never got around to doing that. Because I finished both before the DLC came out. So.
I thought it was like available almost right away. But 'tis only
a matter of time. Was it?
I don't know.
Maybe I'm mistaken. I was pretty sure that the reason I didn't do it was because it wasn't out yet. But maybe it was just because something else came distracted.
Unless there was a fourth DLC or something. I mean, I know there's like the 3 main ones, but... Use
everything we have. I love the art in this game so much.
Yeah, it's great. And they just... I'm so happy they...
I don't even cosplay. Like, I want to just because of these characters.
I'm so happy they just announced that they're bringing the Dragon's Crown Pro to the U.S. Like, they're giving...
What's the difference?
I guess they just, like, added a bunch, like, some stuff. It's very much just, like, a PS4, like, remaster of Dragon's Crown. So, you know, probably streamlined or fixed up, like this one, you know, with all the... you know, they patched it with a bunch of stuff. Added stuff to the PS3 version. All that stuff will be included.
Aren't they working on a game that, or maybe it's already out? I'm not even sure. Like, is Vanillaware working on like a modern game, like a game that takes place like not in a fantasy world?
I have no idea.
I don't think there's like I saw some screenshots of like. Game look like it took Whoa. Like a Vanillaware game that looks like it takes place in modern Japan or something
there,
like
there's
that.
There's a mech one that's coming out soon that looks
maybe that's it.
80. That sounds awesome. Oh man, I'm definitely gonna play that. Yeah, I'm just a really big fan of VanillaWare in general, but this was the game that, like, started it for me. I had no idea what these games, you know, like, what the general feel of the games, the VanillaWare games were, until I played this one, and I was like, oh my gosh, more games like this.
I think this is actually the only one that I have played, unless I'm forgetting something. Have you ever played Grim Grimoire?
I haven't played that one.
I want to say it came out, like, it's sort of surprising, right? But... yeah, but it's kind of weird because I feel like it came out really close to this game, so they must have been working on it at the same time.
Let's figure it out. That's what I'm here for. All right, that one was 2007. Grim Grimoire was. And Odinspear. Also 2007.
Tell me if I'm right. My memory is Odinspear came out in May. Am I remembering that right?
You are super close. Odinspear came out in... Oh, no, it did come out in May. Sorry.
See?
Sorry, my bad.
I just remember these things.
I was looking at the PS4 release. Grim Grimoire came out in April in Japan and then June in North America. So I guess, let's see, April 12th and... May 17th, yeah, a month apart. Wow.
Like, what was
That's
the
crazy?
What was the release difference in Japan then? Was it about the same? Like, I mean, like the space between the two games, was it the same in Japan?
It must have. Well, I'm just looking on Wikipedia, so it'll take a little bit more, I guess, to figure out. But according to Wikipedia, they both came out for Odinspear. They both came out in May. Because it doesn't specify, but the North American release of Grim Grimoire came out after. So I guess Grim Grimoire came out first in Japan, but second in America.
Okay.
So, yeah. Huh. Weird.
Interesting.
This is really fun to play.
Yeah, it's just, it's awesome. Like, and once you get more the kind of, like, skills and stuff, it gets really, the combos just get insane. And it's so much fun.
Did you play Muramasa?
Oh, that's the other VanillaWare game I've played.
Yeah.
I have not finished that one. Is that one still, no. That one came out on Vita now, too, didn't it?
It was Wii originally.
I started playing it on Wii, didn't really like playing it on Wii, and so now I should go play it on Vita.
Yeah, especially since they added a jump button. I really hate it when games use up to jump.
I forgot about that.
And they added the jump button for the
aside from that, I do remember really liking it. Definitely, it was more of an action game and less RPG elements, I think, if I remember.
Yeah.
I can't remember if I played both character stories or only one character story. If I only played one, I couldn't tell you which one it was. I can't remember. But I do remember really liking it.
I mean, it's interesting to see how they kind of get more mileage out of their drawings, and they kind of... they're not, like, animated so much as they're just, like, kind of moved, I guess. Like, keyframed, almost.
Yeah. Sort of a little bit of squash stretch going on.
Yeah.
It works, though.
Yeah, definitely.
What?
And especially looks great in HD.
What are you doing here?
Yeah, I really have been meaning to replay Muramasa on the Vita, because I do have the Vita version.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, but doesn't it have, like, two or three more characters? Like, the Wii version only has two characters. But they're, you know, different. They go through some different levels, some of the same levels. The one specific thing I remember about that game is there's, like, a giant foot boss. which I think is like a Japanese thing, because I've come across that in other games. I think the Jackie Chan NES game has that. Jackie Chan's Action Kung Fu
has a foot monster.
Yeah, like a giant foot, like it like comes from the sky and like stuff.
Huh.
That's that. There's, like, there's a video right there. Where you fight giant feet.
I mean,
that sounds like somebody's fetish. I don't know.
I couldn't remember that wrong, but I that's my memory. I don't remember much else about the game.
You have to ask have to ask Dave about that.
I want to think I might have played. Did I play it during a marathon? Maybe I can't remember.
I don't know.
Speaking of Jackie Chan's Action Kung Fu, my local game store got a bunch of PC Engine stuff in. Maybe a week ago. I went there on Monday and got PC Engine, Jackie Chan, Dragon Egg, Bonk 2 and 3, and I picked up something for you. What was it?
Sidearm Special.
Oh, yeah. Please refrain from making such critical. Oh, yeah, this giant guy with the Robotnik mustache. He looks really weird.
Yeah. Speaking of game stores, I guess.
Chat, by the way.
What's that?
Oh, hey.
What?
We got Metal Jesus in the chat.
Oh, hey there.
Hi.
Howdy.
Speaking of game stores, for those that don't know, I'm sure most people in the chat do know. But Kelsey, you own the store, correct?
I co-own it. Yeah.
Oh, cool. Okay. Called Pink Gorilla.
Exactly. And we actually just got in a bunch of TurboGrafx and PC Engine stuff too. Local guy has been selling his whole collection to us slowly. we're writing him checks like $600 at a time.
So, is that why he's doing it slowly over time?
I mean, I didn't ask him to, but I think it's probably better for him to do it. Just, you know, I mean, it would take a lot longer for me to figure out thousands and thousands of dollars worth of turbo stuff. So it's easier to do like, okay, here's a stack of 10 games or, you know, 20 games even. I can do that. I can hand them a check within like 20 minutes and, you know, it doesn't take super long.
Is there a lot of interest in people buying that stuff up? Or
you know, it's funny. It seems like it's mostly out-of-towners. Like, we'll get an out-of-towner who's like, ooh,
this guy's
I really...
legs are cracking me up.
Yeah, this guy's tired design is hilarious. So people will come in and they'll be like, oh, where's your turbo stuff? And, you know, most of the time we don't have that much because it's just an obscure-ish system and it's expensive and people just don't really sell that kind of stuff to game stores very often. So it's cool to have so much of it right now, and it's so much that it's, I think, overwhelming for the people looking for turbo stuff because they're expecting me to have a couple games and maybe they need one of them, and instead when I present them with a whole case full of games and they need all of them and some of them are $300,
So is this in addition to the TurboGrafx stuff you got, or is that the same?
Part of there's the same guy, and the TurboGrafx stuff was one of the piles he dropped off.
Wow,
man, and that did sell, by the way. I'm sorry, guys.
Oh, it's all right. It's all right, but you know, I'm. It's like one of the last. I guess that the TurboGrafx, Jaguar, and I want to say the Atari Lynx are like the last ones I feel are must-haves for me.
Have you seen some of this stuff so much that, like, you know, when you see a big pile of Japanese PC Engine games, like, do you generally know what they are? Do you look at it and you're like, I have no clue what this is. How do I even look this up?
It depends. For PC Engine, I don't see it often enough to know the prices off the top of my head. But I know how to find them really quickly, of course. For other stuff, I mean, basically any, even obscure Super Nintendo, NES, any of the kind of like normal stuff. Basically anything until you get to something a little bit more obscure than like TurboGrafx, I can tell you just off the top of my head within probably $10 or $15 what it's worth. Wow. That's not like for literally everything, but
yeah.
But yeah, I see stuff often enough that it's just kind of in my head now.
Mm-hmm.
But sometimes stuff will surprise you, you know, like it won't. Something will be $20 forever, and then all of a sudden it shoots up because I didn't notice that a YouTuber did a video on it or something. So it was funny. I had someone on Twitter ask me the other day. They were like, "Hey, why would Little Red Riding Hood Zombie Barbecue rocket up in price? That game, you know, it's like uncommon and it's pretty good. But do you have any idea what happened?" And I was like, "That was me and Metal Jesus. I'm sorry." Not my intention, obviously. Not trying to make prices go up, but I do want to like show off cool games, and it's kind of like a give and take. Like you either have things stay obscure forever and nobody knows about them, or immediately after a video releases, unfortunately, the games go up a little bit.
I think Reggie said almost the exact same thing last week.
Yeah, it's just part of it.
Obviously,
you know,
not trying to do that. Like that's stupid. You know, I'm not, I guess technically I could gain from affecting the market, but I don't hoard things and do a YouTube video about them. Trust me, you can check me out all you want. Come to my store, look in every nook and cranny. I'm not hiding secret stashes of games that I talk about. But yeah, like it just, if you say something to a large audience, you're going to affect demand a little bit. And like Reggie just said, even when the prices go up, it's just temporary. And that's honestly usually true. Maybe it'll stay a little bit more expensive than it was beforehand. But even like Little Red Riding Hood has already gone down a bunch. So that shot up for a month or so after that video came out. And now it's pretty much back down to about the price it used to be.
Yeah, I was telling Reggie last week that, you know, I kind of made a mistake getting on the panic bandwagon when Shenmue 3 Kickstarter was announced, and then like all of a sudden like everyone wants to buy Shenmue 1 and 2, and I had gotten the first one not that long ago, but I still haven't even played. I don't even know if I'm gonna like it, but I'm like, oh my gosh, like I'm going to need to play the second game if I like the first game, and like all of a sudden, like the price on 2 is going way up, and you know I probably spent like $20 or so more than I had to because I was like, oh my gosh, game prices don't go back down. Once they go up, they're up forever, you know. That's not quite true.
Shenmue crashed back down pretty quickly.
Yeah.
That was definitely one of the, I mean, so it, again, it's not just YouTubers, it's just any hype. Like, again, if you just show it to a large audience, the demand is going to be affected because people, you know, something they didn't have in their head before, it's in their head now.
Right.
So, yeah, whether it's a Kickstarter or if it's a YouTuber or whatever, the good news is if you can just be patient and not buy into the hype, you're going to be okay.
Yeah. Yeah. I've tended to whenever Corey makes a video on a game that I'm like, oh, this looks pretty good. I don't think we've ever meaningfully affected the price or availability of any game.
We get people saying like, oh, now it's gonna cost so much money to get it. You know,
well, not enough people watch our like game focused videos to really
have
the attack. But like when you did Gunner's Heaven, for example, I'm like, I better go buy Gunner's Heaven.
Yeah, and it didn't go up after that.
I have no idea if it did, because I stopped looking at it once I bought it.
Yeah, I guess that's the other thing. Is like we don't really, after we already have something, we generally don't like look up how much they're worth. I guess.
Yeah.
It's just not.
Yeah.
Especially since we're like pretty much looking to like not looking to ever sell them.
Right. Yeah. Right. It's like it's mine to have, and if it goes up in price, all that means is I don't have to pay that price.
Right.
Right.
I'm not really concerned if my collection is more valuable or something.
Yeah.
This background looks unfamiliar.
I'm just killing frogs.
But this background, I feel like I would remember this background, but I don't remember it. But maybe it's in the original version.
I don't know. I couldn't tell you. But yeah, oh.
Sorry. Told you there was a risk of that. Now he flew away. Okay.
So that's gonna be cool. I mean, you'll never be at a loss of like things to talk about because you're probably constantly surprised like what comes in and you're like, oh, you know, I want to talk about, like, you did that with the Nintendo television recently, didn't you? Someone traded it in. You're like, yeah, I can definitely do something with this.
To be honest, we don't get like crazy stuff in that often, like very cool stuff, but not obscure enough for me to make a video on it. That doesn't happen that often, but it's really cool when it does, obviously. I mean,
you're working on like nice something with like with the Super NES bike, the exercise bike, right?
Yeah, that I bought at an auction. So that didn't come through the store. That was at the Portland Retro Gaming Expo. They do like a live auction every year, and it gets pretty intense. Like, people drink beforehand and come in. They spend way too much money, and for some reason, I'm convinced it's just because of the size of the bike. So it's like really difficult to move. The bike sold for, I'm pretty sure, like, it sells so infrequently that it's hard to gauge what, like, the real market value is. Mm-hmm. But I'm pretty sure I got a really good deal on it. I paid $560 or $570.
Wow.
And I feel, I mean, I really don't feel like that's a crazy amount of money for what it is and how rare they are and that it's now working. It has all of the paperwork, first of all, so including the receipt of the people who bought it, which to a nerd like me is awesome. And then the other thing was it came with a Super Nintendo and a boxed copy of the Mountain Bike Rally game used with it. So, like, all of those things together, you know, so you don't have to, like, piece them together, seemed, I don't know, I thought it was going to go for more, but, and I wasn't going to bid really any higher, a whole lot higher than I did. I think I set my cap for myself at like, I don't know, 600 absolute maximum. So I got pretty close, but.
So is that for you or the store?
It's for me and it's sitting in the back of the store right now because, you know, I'm in Seattle, so the places are small. I have just have an apartment. I don't have room in here for it, but, I'm hoping that. I don't know that I'm ever going to have a place that has room for it. So it may not stay with me forever. It may go to another home eventually.
But hey, it's such a cool thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. So here's something I hate about it, by the way. It doesn't have any settings for people to like increase or decrease intensity. So when you're, you know, like on a normal exercise bike, you can up the resistance of the pedals so you can work out harder and not have to like spin your legs super fast, right? This does not have that. So to go fast, you just have to be moving really, really fast.
I forgot how to sign my shortcuts for my spells.
I forget how as well.
There's a tutorial for it, but I forgot how to do it. If anybody in the chat remembers, let me know.
I don't remember spells in the original version.
Yeah.
No, the skills is what he's talking about.
Oh,
yeah. I mean, I can add new skills.
It's not in like the start menu. Not like your. Not like the items, but that, yeah.
I mean, it's, let's see, close zoom, show height controllers. I mean, there's
actually, yeah, I don't think it's in that. I think it's if you return to menu, hold on. I think it might be an equipment, actually.
Oh.
Yeah, I feel like that whole, like, sphere grid menu or whatever the heck that is. Like, I think that's new. I'm pretty sure that's new. I don't remember that at all.
Yeah. I wish I could remember.
Yeah,
right?
You know it is. It's L1. That's it. It's L1.
It's been a while.
Okay, I figured it out. It's just.
Oh, you did.
But what is like in your area, do you find that there's a reasonable demand for import stuff? Because like when my local shop got all that PC Engine stuff in, I heard him talking to someone else, and he said, we don't normally take import stuff because there's like, you know, we not a lot of a market for it here. But he said this is just so unusual that we decide to take it.
Yeah. So for it's basically us and then one other store in Seattle that really like do import stuff. Some other stores will have a very small selection, but I imagine because their selection is so small, the people who are interested in import games just kind of don't bother. But we've sort of made ourselves known as a store that carries a lot of import stuff. And, you know, we post about it, and we have, when you come into the store, like right next to all the American sections, you will see a pretty sizable import section next to it for just about all of those things. So we get a pretty decent amount of import sales there. But the other thing I try to do is I try to educate people about imports that are friendly for people who don't speak Japanese. Or just like, so for instance, there are games like, let's say, Super Mario World on Super Nintendo. That game doesn't really have any text in it. So if you want the Super Famicom version, which is about half the price,
right,
I can mod your Super Nintendo for you right now, you know?
Yeah.
And I do that for free. It's so easy with Super Nintendo and with N64 that I just do it for free as long as they're purchasing a game. But yeah, so I've been able to sell a pretty decent amount of, oh, and Game Boy games are one of the other things because region free.
Don't do anything.
Yeah. And for things like Tetris and Dr. Mario and all that stuff, again, no text in them. I'm like, you can just save $2 on this game, or it, and the cover art is just a little different, or you can pay $2 more for the English one, but it's the same thing. So so we've sold a pretty good amount of import stuff just by kind of doing that sort of, I guess, like education
type thing. Right.
Which is cool. I like getting more people into it. And, you know, a lot of times people are like, okay, cool, I can just play Mario Kart for cheaper and they never come back for anything else, but sometimes people will be excited about that. They're like, whoa, I didn't realize it would be so easy for me to play Japanese games. Is there anything you recommend that didn't come out here?
Yeah.
And then you can get somebody into import games. And usually I do that with something really, really simple to start off with, like Puyo Puyo, or, you know, just something that's really simple to grasp, and so that they can see that there are plenty of Japanese games out there that don't really require knowing the language.
Yeah, I mean, I wish my local stores like wouldn't be like opposed to it. Like another weird sort of thing, I want to say a couple months ago when I was in there, I overheard some guy like trying to trade in some Vita games. He's like, oh, we don't take Vita games anymore. They just don't sell. It's like kind of crazy because like people who are into Vita collecting are like really into Vita collecting.
Right.
But again, I guess it's just that case of like, they don't think to go to that particular store to get Vita games, or, you know, they already know what they're looking for. You know, it's just, I guess it's interesting how every store kind of finds their niche when it, in one sense you think, well, like, oh, you would think every store could be good at everything, but that's probably not really the case.
Yeah, well, so the other thing is, like, for the other stores, I mean, even if they did want to start, you know, focusing on imports more, they basically have to bulk order a bunch of import stuff to begin with, because people just aren't going to trade it in very often. Mm-hmm. And that's true, even, I think we have a pretty good import crowd, and it's still true for us. So, I mean, I am constantly buying, I'm trying to buy collections that people, you know, are selling on, like, basically Japanese eBay, the Japanese versions of, you know, auction sites and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And import that sort of that thing and then resell it, because that's the only way to really get and keep a good stock of import stuff in the store.
Mm-hmm.
Is that kind of something that you learned just kind of on the spot, or is that something you thought, like, as you were you ran into a situation where it's like, oh, like maybe if I suggest this to them, you know, like,
what?
I mean, did you
just, which part?
Like getting people in the imports. I mean, is it something like, oh, you know, I guess I can, like, it's just kind of something you learned.
I think just from it doing was basically it. Just when I learned that import games were cool and easy, at least for, you know, for some things. Mm-hmm. It's harder for some systems, like, you know, 360 or PS2 or something. But when I learned that it was super easy, I just wanted to tell everybody. I was like, isn't this cool? You know? and that started to create, slowly, but it started to create a little bit more of a demand for it. And I also, it was kind of a gamble too. I was like, I'm just going to go spend, you know, $1,000 on import stuff and just put it in the store and see where that gets us. We had already had a pretty decent import section because we've always done that. But I decided I was really going to like bulk it up and advertise it. And yeah, it's not like the thing that is driving our sales. It's honestly, we probably about break even on it, but I think it's really cool for people to see. Even if they don't buy that much import stuff, or if they're kind of on the fence about it, it still makes the store look good, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Can I plant some more of these things?
Plant some seeds. You haven't gotten a sheep seed yet, huh? I think that comes later.
What is
there
it?
Is
yeah. I don't think it's too
game.
Far from the game.
Yeah, there's a seed that in this game you plant a seed, and then when it grows, instead of like fruit or whatever, you grow sheep off of the plant, like literal sheep, and then they just start walking around.
Yep, and then you attack them, and then you pick up like lamb meat that you can consume. It's maybe my favorite thing about this game.
So I guess a big thing that kind of happened this week, a lot of people were talking about, Kelsey, I don't know. Do you have a Patreon account?
Do I?
Yeah.
No, I don't.
Have you been following any of the stuff that is happening with it?
Oh yeah.
I mean, for people that don't know, Patreon changed the way that they're, handling their fees this week. And, instead of the person that you're donating to, like, say, like, us, we usually handle the fees, and instead they're making it so that the patrons have to handle that fee instead, which is, like, a really dumb move, I think. So, right. So
and none of the creators want that. Like,
no one
every
wants.
Every single person would rather eat the fee themselves than push that onto the people... Well, who are graciously giving them money. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like,
well, and the big thing, you know, Corey linked me to an explanation that, you know, some other Patreon person, you know, wrote up for his audience. And I agree with it 100% because who this is hurting the most are the people who are doing $1 or $2 pledges. And those are the best and most important pledges. No one should underestimate the value of a $1 and $2 pledge, because there can be lots of those. And if someone backs out, it only goes down by $1 or $2. You still have, like, you can still, like, kind of guess, like, what your level is going to be. You aren't going to have these wild swings with the small donations. You know, $20 is great, you know, $50 or whatever more, that's great and fantastic, but it's also totally understandable when it's like, well, I just can't afford to do this every month anymore. And it's those small $1 and $2 pledges that are so sustainable, and that is what this is hurting. And that's just so frustrating how they did not see and understand that. And so people are losing money, tons of money, because people are backing out of their pledges, and it makes sense why.
Yep.
Yeah, it sucks. I mean, I had a bunch of, I don't have any $1 pledges, but I have a ton of $2 pledges spread out a bunch of different places, and I haven't dropped any because I want to keep supporting the people I'm supporting. But yeah, I mean, it's not fair.
Yeah. So, I mean, I guess it sounds like Kickstarter has their own, like, beta Patreon alternative. I think it's called Drip.
Yeah, hopefully that works. Oh, to answer your question, the fee on the new fee is, like, 35 cents for, like, that's the base. You get charged 35 cents for whatever level your pledge is, and that's per
person. And if you have
person.
A lot of $1 per pledges.
Pledge. Yeah.
Like, plus it adds up, like, so quick.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, if you had 10 different $1 pledges, your fees went up like 30. You're now paying like 35 to 40% more than you were paying. That's not fair.
Yeah. And the other, like, just really silly thing is if you're supporting multiple people, they charge it on the date of the month.
Yes.
You made the pledge. So if you pledged to 10 different people and that was on 10 different days of the month, you're going to get like 10 individual charges with 38 cents tacked on.
Right.
On your credit card bill. It looks stupid.
And not only that, but I mean, even for, you know, the creators, it's stupid because one of the great things about Patreon is like at the end of the beginning of the month, you get this huge lump sum of money. To be able to, I mean, the way we do is we buy stuff with our own money and we kind of pay ourselves back with it after the fact. And when you're getting like, you know, a couple dollars here and there, you know, like throughout the month, like instead of just getting it as one big thing, it's just kind of like, oh, well, it makes it harder to really divide things up, I guess.
Yeah. I mean, you know, Patreon is still, you know, one of the best ways to support us, and you know, we're not like going to be leaving it anytime soon because we really can't,
right?
You know, if there are alternative ways that are friendlier with you know, more respectful of people's money, then we will definitely join that as a, you know, as an alternative and see how that goes too,
right?
But for now, you know, Patreon is hugely important for us.
Yeah, it's going to be difficult to get everyone to switch over to, like, even if Drip is amazing, it's going to be difficult to get everyone to leave the Patreon and
right.
Just because that's like a time and effort thing. Even if they do want to continue supporting you, it's like, okay, I have to enter my credit card information again. And,
we can't leave for those reasons.
And even, you know, like the people that left, they have left because of this change. Like, if they kind of walk it back and decide, like, okay, we changed our mind, we're not going to do this now, the chances of getting back those people that left are small, too, I think. Because, you know, once they're kind of, like, out, like, I mean, there's a lot of people that, like, you know, close their accounts completely because of it.
Yeah.
And those people are not going to come back.
I'll be curious if this, I guess it's already available, but I think to be a creator on it, you have to, it's like invite only right now or something. But
yeah. Oh, for
this Drip that Kickstarter, it's Kickstarter, right? That's
yes.
Doing yeah. That. I'm wondering, can you use your Kickstarter account for that?
I don't know.
Because that would definitely make it a little easier, I think, for people to, you know, probably most people have a Kickstarter account, and that would kind of make it a little easier to bring people into that.
Yeah, that's true. Hopefully, like, I can't even remember if Kickstarter saves, like, your credit card or PayPal information or whatever, but...
Yeah, I don't know.
It's just I guess it's just frustrating because, like, why can't... Like, people were obviously happy, especially, you know, with, like, the state of, you know, YouTube ad revenue. People had gone, like, pretty, you know, the Patreon, taken the Patreon approach. And it's just like, why can't they just, like, be cool with, and, like, leave it alone? And just be happy with what's happening.
Like, the biggest change that they made, like, a year or two ago, which was a change that I think everyone liked,
was to show everybody what they're changed, really...
Yeah, they showed, like, instead of, like, the total amount, what the all of the pledges add up to, it changed it to where it shows
after all the
just just what the person that you're supporting is actually pulling in after fees. Which everyone loved that. Everyone was like, this is great. Cool. You know, so yeah, so you get a clear idea of what the person is actually making. And so, but yeah, I don't know. It's really silly. They had a good thing going and now no one thinks they have a good thing going.
Yeah. So it'll just be interesting. I'm surprised that they haven't like walked it back already.
Yeah.
I mean, it's kind of surprising.
I was really expecting a statement from them
like the day after.
Soon. I mean, there's still Monday, I guess, because they launched it on Friday, I think. But I don't know.
I feel like this is like almost like the biggest, like, just completely. I'm not even sure what the word I'm looking for. I mean, just a business decision made on just really shaky foundation of something no one wants. I feel like I haven't seen something this bad since like the Xbox One announcement, which they walked back on like everything they planned for that real fast,
mm-hmm.
like within a week.
Yeah. And that's like the smart thing to do, or, you know, at least in their situation, that was the smart thing to do because that, I mean, Sony is still winning this console war, quote unquote, but like it wouldn't have even been close.
Yeah.
Had they kept all that stuff. I mean, it was, I like my Xbox One, but that, I mean, that was horrible. I don't think I would have gotten one even.
I mean, and that is absolutely... like why they are where they are now is because of that. And but it would have been even worse of a situation if they hadn't walked back like immediately.
Right.
Right.
Well, it's too bad. It's too bad. Hopefully.
But I mean, there's still a chance that this could all change because at the end of the day, this was intended to make Patreon more money. Or people related to Patreon or shareholders or whatever. But, and well, it's not going to make them more money because people are leaving. So,
yeah. I mean, we lost like 11 patrons, I think, the first day.
Yeah, maybe they're just giving the weekend to look at it and how much they've lost. But, you know, if the amount of people leaving has outweighed their gain from, you know, this new 35-cent thing, then then it'll be, you know, then they probably will walk it back, which is why, like, I don't think it's a bad thing for people to leave right now to kind of, like, send a message, quote-unquote.
Yeah.
And I've seen that from a lot of creators where they're like, if you need to leave and, like, you know, switch to PayPal donations or something like that, you know, do it.
I mean, we had a lot of people switch over to PayPal. Like within the like first day.
I'm somewhat surprised PayPal doesn't have a version of this. Like right now they're just getting like a percent. They're like getting a cut of the cut, you know, because it goes through PayPal. But PayPal could make their own thing, take out the middleman.
Yep.
Yeah, I thought.
I don't know. You know, be good.
I thought you could set like recurring donations on PayPal, but
you can. It's just not organized like it is.
Yeah, it's not like you can't. Yeah. Right, you can't like share how much. Because like I feel like with Patreon, like there's like the reason it works so well is because you feel like you're giving to a pool of money that is making a difference. And if you're just giving a donation to someone through a service that you can't see how much other people are donating, that you don't know, like, oh, okay, well, I'm donating $2, but does that really add up to anything? But then you see that, oh, well, this person is making like $700. Like, they could actually do like real legitimate stuff with this amount of money, and you know, every little bit is adding to that, you know. And so it's like, it's a difference of like, am I buying this guy's next hamburger, or is this like contributing in a major way to his next project?
Right.
And that is what the visibility of the money on Patreon really helps with, I think.
Have you ever done or tried or seen Ko-fi or Ko-fi? however you spell that one, the K-O-F-I.
That's I heard about that recently, but I have no idea like what it even is.
It's basically the same thing, except I don't know if you can do recurring payments through that one, but the idea is like, oh, it's like tipping. It's like a tip jar. So, you know, buy the person you like a coffee, and that's why it's called a coffee. So you tip like $3 at a time, and that can add up for a lot of people. But that's, it's a little different because it's more like a tip jar. It's like, you don't have to, unlike Patreon where you're giving like perks and rewards and stuff for different tiers, it's just a tip. That's all it is. So people who don't expect anything in return, which can be really cool if you're someone like me who's just too busy to... I mean, I don't have one yet either. I don't have any way to take money right now. But it seems like a cool way for someone who maybe can't promise a lot of Patreon reward stuff to do that, you know, to still make a little bit of money.
And YouTube sort of has a tip jar sort of functionality built into it. And, you know, sometimes we get like the super chat thing, which is kind of fun.
Yeah.
Yeah, I want to do one eventually. I just, right now I don't have the, I wouldn't want to do anything I don't have the time to actually devote to.
Right. I mean, it's tough. I mean, I guess, like, we've built up a decent amount of exclusive content on ours, on our Patreon. But it's like, it's always, it's more, like, we just call them video logs. They're about, like, different things. They're more unedited, they're like, casual things.
Low production sort of. Yeah. Just fun things that we
get
think
to
people
know
might
better
appreciate.
Type stuff.
Yeah, it's like no one needs to think they're like missing out on like major episodes or something by not being on Patreon. But because I've ever seen a tweet of someone who just signed up on Patreon, they're like, "Whoa, you signed up for My Life and Gaming on Patreon!" All of a sudden, there's like twice the videos, and it's like, okay, first of all, it's definitely not twice the videos. Second of all, they are. I mean, they're not bad videos. They're just, like, not things that we would, like, feel good about releasing on the channel. Because they're not our, like, episode quality that we would consider.
Yeah. I mean, I think they're fun. But they're, like, different stuff. Like, there's one where I went through, like, all the Phantasy Star stuff that I have.
We just did a blooper, a new blooper reel that we put on Patreon.
Yeah.
That's fun.
Yeah. Do one of those like a year. We like save them up throughout the year. Our bloopers are not very, as you can imagine, are not very exciting. I guess.
I've only had one exciting blooper and I ended up just including it in the end of one of my videos.
Yeah.
If you watch my Mark III video, I juggled it in my hands for a minute trying not to drop it. I caught it. I did not drop it on the ground, but I don't. People like that. I don't think all my other blooper reels are just like me not knowing how to talk, though, so it's not very exciting.
It is really difficult to talk on camera. I mean, I spent some time yesterday watching your Kirby video.
Oh yeah, that one's horrible. That was the first one I did, and it's just not good.
I know, but you're like talking pretty. You know, you don't like there's no like jump cuts that I noticed. I mean.
Yeah, that was how, until I discovered that everybody uses jump cuts, like, or at least will mask the fact that they're doing,
they're editing what
jump
they're saying.
Cuts by, like, you know, putting something else over the screen.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what I do now, because it makes a lot more sense. But yeah, that video was really hard to do, because I did not know what I was doing. I really didn't. And I feel like they've gotten a lot better since then because I'm a little better at the whole recording thing and just putting together the best takes of things.
Mm-hmm. But do you write a script or?
I write a like bullet point sheet. So I write like sort of a script, but I don't read from a script.
See, I always think it's so funny because. Like, I think, you know, between the people who can just, you know,
can just
spew it off off top of their head, and they can talk about and be engaging versus the people who write scripts, I think there's like, each of them envy the other, because there's always people who are like, you know, we'll talk about like, well, I'm writing this script for something. They're like, oh man, you guys are like way above me. Like, I don't write scripts. And we're like, we think it's amazing that you don't write scripts.
Yeah.
You know?
Then we get people that say, you know, for like RGB stuff, like, oh, looks like you guys are reading off a card. It's like, well, I want you to try saying all this information, getting it all in there without having a teleprompter.
Yeah. For what it's worth, the videos I do with Metal Jesus do not have scripts or anything. He is really cool because he just goes in blind. Like, we maybe discuss it a little bit beforehand.
It really
and then
helps
we do, like,
if you
one...
have somebody to work off of. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's true. We do one take, and if we did something like super wrong, like we actually said something incorrectly, then we'll do a second take. But otherwise, it's one take.
What was that? Did something fall?
Yeah. Sorry. There's some chaos going on in my place right now. I apologize.
It's all right. It just sounded like something seriously fell over. But yeah, it's much easier when you, I mean, it just like when you have somebody to kind of bounce back and forth.
Yeah. But yeah. It was funny. I don't know if you saw the soundtracks video that we did with Game Dave, but I mean, a lot of our bloopers in the blooper video we just did come from that, because it's so funny because Dave is like such a professional at, you know, talking.
Yeah, he's so good at stuff. And there's a lot of times where, you know, he'll kind of go off script a little bit and we're just like, we don't know what to do. There's one where he says, you know, we said, you know, we point at something, we're like, oh, they're the same but different. And he like catches us completely off guard and he goes, okay, how? And we're just like, have nothing.
Well, I think the reason he said that is because we just like weren't moving the conversation. We're just like, wow, they look the same but they're different.
Yeah.
I mean, but just, it's so funny because we just do not have the right sorts of personalities.
Yeah.
Or I know, at least for me, like, my thought processes are just so scattered. Like, I can't, yeah, I mean, you could just tell right now, like, I can't get a thought out concisely when it's coming off the top of my head. I need to, like, type it out. And I need to, like, edit it and edit it again until I get, you know, okay, this is what I want to say and this is the best way to say it. I think some people might have a connotation of, like, when I see comments of, like, you're just reading off of cards or are you using a teleprompter? Like, I think some people mistakenly believe that, like, if you're doing that, then you're, like, reading someone else's words. Like, someone else is like the mastermind behind this show, and you're just the face of it. It's like, geez, why would
anyone think that?
Given
our priest,
I get that constantly. It's so frustrating.
Yeah, because.
Oh, God, sorry. I was just.
Well, I mean, it's just like, why would anyone think that, like, someone with our Monty Corey's presentation.
Yeah,
skills.
Yeah. Who would want to get us? Like,
who would hire us to read their script?
Yeah, it's true.
I mean, it's a hilarious thought.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, I do think some people think that. Like, there was a recent comment. I think it was just on RGB 101. Like, say, like, this looks like an advertisement. Are you just reading off the cards?
Yeah.
It's like, okay, yes, we are reading.
It's an infomercial, is what they said.
Wrote it. It's our own thoughts. We just, and at the end of the day, like, I totally don't care if someone can tell I'm reading a teleprompter, because before, when I was like trying to memorize my lines for on camera, like, it made every shoot just like super stressful. And
yeah,
like, as soon as I switched to teleprompter, I'm like, okay, this is better. I can do this a lot more often without like being stressed about it.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's really difficult to just to memorize a script. That's what I tried to. That's what that Kirby video was me trying to like memorize a script and then also sort of reading off of my like laptop at the same time, which is why it looks like I'm not looking at the camera. Yeah, it's very difficult.
When did you do that Kirby video?
Gosh, over a year ago. It was before 2016's Portland Retro Gaming Expo.
Okay. So you're.
I've not made a whole lot of videos. I'm aware that I have not made a lot of videos in a year.
Is Kirby maybe your favorite series?
No, it was just one that I'd been reading a lot of, like, Japanese interviews, and they were, like, really interesting to me, so I was like, I'm just gonna do that, because it's not something that's had, like, a bazillion games. I feel like I can cover it in one video, and I can't at all, so I've switched to doing much smaller topics, which I think works a lot better.
I actually just got, like, a week or so ago, this Kirby, hardbound Kirby art book. From Japan. Oh, cool. And it's got like so much stuff in it.
Oh, man, that's adorable. Is that like a recent art book?
Yeah, it just came out. I've had ambitions for a while to do like a big Kirby video, like really comprehensive. And like this, you know, if I feel like maybe this is the year. And Corey like linked me. He's like, "Hey, you should get this." And I'm like, "Oh yeah."
We like it's a always great to have stuff like that, especially like if you're gonna be doing a video on the series. You know, we're just big fans of like you know you got the or got the manual for the bike. You know, it's just like such a good thing to show like that, like the paper materials and stuff like that, like on camera.
Because it's something that people will probably never see. Like, you know, it's great reference material.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. And it's just fun to look at. I don't know. Yeah. I have a lot of art books. I like them.
Yeah, but yeah. I mean, like...
I've not really been a big art book guy, but, like, I feel like I might, you know, for example, that, like, I feel like I might sort of be starting to get into it because it's just, it's good stuff to show on camera. Like... You know, there it's sometimes some of this artwork, like it's stuff that hasn't really been shared online, or at least not shared in high quality.
It's true. Although their demise was sudden,
Valentine was still our. This guy's gonna be the bad guy, isn't he? And while the I feel like he's gonna.
Could you not tell? He's definitely not a good guy. That's for sure.
Yeah, he does look like Robotnik, though. That's funny. Or, I'm sorry, Eggman. He'll always be Robotnik to me.
He's just, like, carrying the flagon horn thing, like, all the time. But
that cauldron is I mean, it's just, like, story. The way that his legs look and how far apart they are. Which is what I think is so funny.
Like... His abs are just like this, like, like sectioned off portion of his body. There's just like an outline around them. How did you stop the magic furnace?
There must be some type. That's not even remotely the weirdest like character design that Vanillaware has done either.
Yeah. There's nothing to do.
There is some like story parts to this, but I don't know. The fun part, it's not that much.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not even paying attention.
It's still an RPG, but.
I mean, what I'll probably end up doing is.
I didn't find myself caring too much. I just wanted to beat people up.
Now, what I'll probably do is I'll probably start over. I mean, I'll get 2 hours into it. It's like that's like a half an evening, really, if I start over.
So, I mean, it's very sort of inspired by, like, I wouldn't say it's based on Norse mythology, but there's a lot of inspiration from it. It probably draws from that more than anything else, really.
Yeah. So, Troy, do you want to talk about your whole setup? Maybe give a little background. Kelsey, I don't know if she's like probably has no idea like what you've been through in the last month.
Yeah, so
no.
Are you a big fan of like game setups? Like getting everything to work?
I mean you guys are definitely the resource to go to when it comes to like making everything look and sound nice. I play so much handheld stuff that it doesn't come up very often, but now, I mean, I just got a 4K TV so I can play Monster Hunter in all of its glory.
Well, see, I mean, that's kind of the problem, is like, that's where it all starts, right? You introduce the 4K TV, and you realize nothing is as simple as it used to be. I mean, and two, I feel like the fact that we do this, the type of show that we do, like, I need everything to be like really functional and streamlined, you know? So I can capture any system at any time and, you know, whatever quality that I want to without like tearing everything apart. And so, but like, there's kind of this, you know, weird juxtaposition of technologies that don't want to work well together. And there's not a lot of conversation out there about what do you do to make them work well together if you want them to. And sort of kind of my problem that I was dealing with was, and two, I guess the other thing is, you know, most people are probably just having like one or two systems hooked up to their TV at once, whereas I've got, you know, probably like 30, I don't know.
I'm going to run to the bathroom really quick.
Okay. But anyway, so I've been trying to use separate switchers and splitters for 4K stuff. You know, the PS4 Pro, and I just got the Xbox One X. But then I've also got the OSSC, which outputs these weird refresh rates from all of the retro consoles, which is very non-standardized and doesn't work very nicely with every HD TV. Well, thankfully, it seems to work pretty well with a lot of 4K TVs. And I can use, like, all of the OSSC modes, or pretty much all of the OSSC modes, with, you know, various systems on the 4K TV. But what I was finding was that when I was trying to route the OSSC through these same switchers, they're rated for 4K and HDR and all that stuff for my other systems, it was having this breakdown communicating between the... It works directly to my TV, but once you pass it through the switcher and the splitter, there's just this breakdown communication. And sometimes it works, most of the time it doesn't, and it just was not reliable. So anyway, I realized that I had been kind of wasting money by trying to save money and avoiding getting like a proper AV receiver to route all of these devices through. And so I finally gave up on all that. And I'm after I shoot some of these devices that I've been wasting money on for an episode that I hope to do in the next month or two, I'll shoot some stuff of those devices, and I'm going to sell them to get my money back, because I just had to buy a pretty expensive receiver. Pretty expensive to get all the features I need, because what I discovered was I tried to buy a cheap one, and thankfully, you know, Best Buy doesn't have restocking fees, and it was easy to take back. But the problem is, if you need dual HDMI outputs from a receiver, for one, just the regular output probably doesn't actually carry sound. It has to be like a Zone 2 feature to go out.
You want to explain what Zone 2 is?
Which I need for recording.
Did you already explain what Zone 2 is?
Well, Zone 2 is like a totally separate, like, you can control what is going to Zone 1, and you can control what's going to Zone 2, which Zone 2, like, is intended to be like sending the audio or video to another room. But in my case, I just want to send it to a capture card. But the other tricky thing is, so I have to have Zone 2 feature. And the other tricky thing is, I need HDR 10 support to use the HDR mode that games on PS4 Pro and Xbox One X use.
So all HDRs are not like the same thing. They're not created equal.
If you see, oh, this supports HDR, well, it might just be Dolby Vision, which is used in, like, movies. It's like different HDR standards. Now, my TV supports Dolby Vision as well as HDR10, and I think maybe some other HDR mode. But for games, games are HDR10, at least on these consoles. So it has to support that. And when I tried to buy a much less expensive receiver, oh, it supports HDR, but only Dolby Vision. So anyway, I unfortunately discovered that that receivers that are
I have no idea what just happened, but my Xbox One just turned on by itself.
And, like, screwed
I
up
have that together. Problem with my TV too. It'll just randomly switch to a different.
And now it's like sending my Xbox One. I have no idea why that just happened. My Xbox One just turned on. It's like, I don't even, you know, I don't even have like the Kinect hooked up or anything. So it's not like I said Xbox on or anything. It just turned on by itself.
My TV will do that thing if I like, if I dock the Switch while I have something else on, it'll just switch over to that. It's like, you clearly want this now. Doesn't matter. You're in the middle of the game.
Well, you know what? Turn on. Why don't I play Cuphead?
it sounds like Destiny, I guess, at this point.
Yeah.
No, it sounds like Cuphead.
I mean, is that okay? Yeah, is that Cuphead. Is everybody okay if they see me be really bad at Cuphead? Probably.
Have you played it yet?
I played like 2 levels.
Okay. It's very hard. So we'll see how you do. Probably better than me, but.
Oh, come on. Cuphead needs an update. The update size is around 7.1 gigabytes.
Wow. What?
Man.
Can you play it? No. Can you play it without doing the update?
Let's see what happens. No, it doesn't look like it.
So
this could take a while to update. We'll let you know when it's ready to use. We'll let you know.
You know, I'm new to the. I didn't have an Xbox One until the X came out, and you know, so I've been kind of new to this interface and everything. I am not a fan of the interface, but I read across something really weird. I got Doom and Rise of the Tomb Raider on Black Friday deals. And I was installing them over the weekend. And what was interesting, I guess they did some sort of thing where they made an update where I think the Xbox One X, you know, there are certain files that it needs, and the Xbox One S, there's certain files it needs, you know. So there's no reason to install like low res textures on the X if it's only using the high res textures, and there's no reason to install high res textures on the S if it's only using low res textures and other things like that. So what was interesting was it was actually installing only like 700 some megabytes, I want to say, from the Doom disk, and it downloaded like 58 gigs from the internet. Now I assume if I wasn't connected to the internet, it would install the whole disk and I could play the disk that way, of course, you know, in launch form. But it was interesting, like from the get-go, it like showed installing 700 some megabytes from the disk, and you know, 58 gigabytes from the internet. But I accidentally booted, like it said ready to play, and I didn't actually mean to start the game. Like I was just like trying to like check like something about, because I love how on the PS4 you can like check like patch information and stuff like that, and it's just like I don't think that exists on the Xbox One, which is disappointing. But
so,
but
really
anyway,
quick,
I was just,
what I think I'm gonna do is I think that I'm going to just kind of veer off into like something totally different. And I've wanted to play this since I got it, and I have never played it, but I feel like it's just going to be a good action game for me to play. I'm going to try out this from Limited Run.
You don't want to share it with anybody.
Next Machina,
oh,
Death
okay.
Machine. So I'm going to play it. Is that okay?
Is that yeah.
Go for it.
But anyway, so what's interesting about this, I launched Doom on accident and I'm like, oh, well, I guess I'm going to just maybe play a few minutes to see how this is. And what was so crazy was that even though it said it was ready to play, like, I was like, wow, the game looks really, really dark. Like, this is weird. And I was like, it was like to the point where I'm thinking something's wrong here. And I think what it was it was letting me play the game, but like all of the high res textures weren't finished downloading. And so what was not available was just showing up as black. And so the game was like sort of visible, but very, very dark. Like my gun was like black. And I thought it was just like the lighting. Like I thought it was just like really dark. And then like I quit the game and let it finish and saw it. And I went back. And like I could see, like I actually stopped and looked at a video of the opening on YouTube. I'm like, okay, things are actually supposed to be a lot more visible. And I let the download finish, and then I could see it. I just thought that was so weird that it let me play the game like without all of that patch stuff finished. It was really weird. But yeah, like the Xbox One installs patch are like really, really slow. Like it takes forever.
I'm surprised there's a patch for this. Usually there. And it's. Why is everything over a gigabyte? At least it has up to like 1.5 on the disc. So hopefully.
But anyway, about the receiver. So I discovered that to get HDR10, the HDR format that PS4 and Xbox One games use, as well as multi-zone output, just so I can record games that I'm playing, to get both of those things in one unit, it's a higher price tier than I wanted to pay. I thought I was done buying expensive things for a while, and now I am really done buying expensive things. I was lucky enough that I had the money to do this, but I. You know, I was not far off from being to the point where I'm like, maybe I shouldn't do this. But anyway, so I got this Denon AV receiver. John Linneman, I know from Digital Foundry, uses a similar model. And I was specifically getting his input because he has used the OSSC with it. And so I was like, oh, okay, well, I better look at Denon's. And one of our Patreon supporters helped me sort of zero in on a model that was on sale. It was definitely the best value. And so anyway, I've got it all hooked up.
OSSC. And it works.
It works. Things freaking work. And it's just such a relief because, like, I had been struggling.
And it's great
till
you get your credit card statement.
Yeah, I'm like, I'm all like, yeah, I'm saving money. I'm taking the smart route. I'm buying these less expensive 4K switchers and 4K splitters, and they most of the time work with the PS4 and the Xbox, but not all the time. But most of the time, it's fine, and it kind of doesn't work with the OSSC at all. Well, great. So, but now I've got.
You were like, having an issue with your splitters that you had before because with the OSSC 1.6, which has the HDMI out on it, you're getting crackling audio.
Yeah, the audio was popping like crazy, and sometimes the picture was dropping too. But the audio was just like popping like crazy, especially with Super Nintendo and PlayStation 2. Just got. I think because it's like, you know, it's like kind of a weird sample rate, I guess, because it's like going along with weird video refresh. But anyway, so yes, it's such a relief. I've got, you know, I've got all of my video stuff like routed exactly the way it needs to be. The OSSC works perfect. I mean, I can play 5X Super Nintendo. No audio pops, no issues. The one thing I haven't been able to do is 480i pass-through. But I think there could possibly be a workaround around that. But I guess it kind of makes sense. Because it's like, I mean, it's really designed for like progressive stuff. the, you know, the digital inputs. But I think there might be a mode on the receiver that would let me do that. But it's not really that big of a deal anyway. But I mean, yeah, things are working and life is good. So yes, that was a long, expensive saga, and you'll be getting to hear more about that when I do that 4K TV episode, hopefully in a month or two. But I mean, I just think that's such an important topic because no one. I mean, yeah, I guess there probably are people talking about it, but I mean, you know, I don't get around the internet enough, so I'm going to talk about it anyway. I mean, there just needs to be more information out there that, like, clearly explains, like, what you're getting yourself into with that. Like, yeah, if you're just, like, hooking up systems directly to your TV, you don't have to worry about capturing stuff. You don't have to worry about combining weird retro refresh rates with modern HDR stuff. Then the price of entry for 4K could actually be really affordable. But there can be a lot of hidden costs if you have complicated needs, like we do, just out of the nature that we do a show about retro video quality and stuff like that, makes things very complicated. But yeah, I mean, there's just, the basics are actually not that complicated. You do need to be aware of what kind of wires you're buying or, you know, switchers or receivers or things like that. And you could get away with just using a cheaper receiver or splitter if you had much simpler needs. But my needs were unfortunately not very simple. And also, this game looks really pretty.
Yeah, it's like all voxels, it looks like.
I like how you're, like, jumping, like, around, like, the edges of this platform. Like, it, like, changes sides.
Right. Kelsey, have you played this before?
I didn't. I actually watched Metal Jesus play it when we had our... If you guys saw, we, like, did a Oregon trip where we all just hung out at the beach for a few days and played it with video games. This is one of the games he was showing us. It looked really cool, but isn't this one of the ones that Limited Run is
doing?
Yeah,
this is.
They just did it.
Okay, well, I will have it soon.
That's right. You know, Limited Run has a thing where they pick like a store, like one store per area, and they give them like a couple of copies of each of their games, and you have to. Don't you have to like you have to sell it for like the same amount or like just like above? I mean, I don't
yeah,
know.
Yeah, there's a
I don't know if it's something you can talk about
it
or not.
Sell it for. We don't really get a discount on it, so like it's pretty much just done as a service, to be honest.
Right.
I've known Douglas for a long time, so like since Limited Run started, basically.
Mm-hmm.
So he was cool and was like, "Hey, you know, I can send you like two or three, possibly four copies of our games." And I was sort of like, I guess my store was kind of like the test store to see if that was something that would work. And it worked out pretty well. Honestly, they don't really sell very well in my store anymore. I think the Limited Run hype has started to die a little bit. I still like being able to offer
it's very interesting. I mean, like the ones that they just did this weekend sold out pretty quick, like Double Dragon 4 and the River City Ransom one. But it's just, there's a lot of people doing the limited releases now, and I think that some people are starting to kind of get overwhelmed.
Exactly. I mean, I am too. I'm still getting one of each of the Limited Run things, but I basically don't do any special reserve or IM8-bit or anything unless it's something I really, really want.
Right.
I used to do one of each too. I used to get a PS4 copy and a Vita copy. I stopped doing that really quick. I sold off all of them. If it came out on both, I sold all of my PS4 copies, and like, I'm never gonna play a PS4 copy over a Vita copy, probably. So,
Voltar, what was I needing to pay attention to the chat for? You asked something about FrameMeister, something that I'm not quite sure what you were talking about.
Yeah,
I should get one of those at some point.
Oh, FrameMeister. Yeah, I mean, There hasn't been a lot of talk about them like being on low supply at all, like in months now. It's interesting because they were there was a big deal made like at the beginning of the year about them. Like, oh, they're gonna be harder to get because they're stopping making a specific chip that they use, like the manufacturer. And then we just haven't heard anything about it in a long time.
Oh, Voltar, I think I may have solved that issue. I need to test all my systems. But what I actually did, I moved the OSSC to where the Framemeister was, because now that I've got the OSSC working flawlessly, I'm not intending to use the Framemeister a whole lot, which I know will make Voltar happy.
That's not true for me, though. I don't have a TV to, like, really...
Not yet.
Or a
not
capture
yet,
card
but
to
we'll
really
get there.
Support.
Like, but for right now, I'm probably mostly going to only use the Framemeister for, A, if I need a shot that specifically needs to be a Framemeister shot for one reason or another. Two, it's just, like, a second video processor for, like, a second stream source. Like, if I'm... Like, if I have friends over and I'm streaming, two systems at once, and I just need something, just a second source, I'll probably use the Framemeister for that. And also, maybe for 480i stuff, we'll have to see what I'm feeling like whenever I next play a 480i game.
Yeah.
The OSSC is working perfectly with everything. I can capture it. I can play it in all modes. Like, there's no, with what I've got going on now, there's pretty much no downside. But anyway, Voltar, what I did, the Framemeister was coming straight out of the G-SCARTs, and I always have had to have the sync stripping turned on the G-SCARTs. For it to work with the Framemeister. And I had to use the sync stripping adapter with the Framemeister for some reason. I'm not really sure why. On top of that. It doesn't make sense, but that was the only way I could ever get it to work. Anyway, so when we passed it through the Extron...
it just sounds funny because it sounds like there's like an earthquake or something.
Yeah, they're trying to set up a new like TV stand behind me here, and they just knocked over a ton of my Wii games.
Oh, whoops!
What kind of like TV stand? So you're like you kind of building like a new setup, or is it?
Kind of. It just my old TV stand is like from Target and is not strong, and I don't really trust a 4K TV on it. You know, it's like 65 inches and extremely heavy.
right. So what TV did you get?
Samsung 80,000, I'm being told.
Oh, okay.
I'm not as good at this stuff as you guys are.
I don't know that much about the Samsung models. I think Nick from HD Retrovision might have a 4K Samsung, and I believe it works quite well with the OSSC. That's like the main thing I want to know about TVs. How does it work with the OSSC?
Yeah.
But anyway, Voltar. So I moved the OSSC to where the Framemeister was, and I was able to get the PC Engine to work with the OSSC through the G-SCART if I turn sync stripping off. I have no idea why. Maybe you know why. I don't know why. But it works. But then here's the interesting thing. Now that I moved the Framemeister to where the OSSC was, the PC Engine is working with it too, even with sync stripping on the G-SCART turned off, which the G-SCART ultimately, it feeds a PVM, which feeds the Extron, which feeds the Framemeister.
Did you figure out your audio issue? Yes.
With the Framemeister?
No, you were having... Whereas only...
Oh, the PC Engine? Well, I... No, I don't know. I'm only getting one channel of audio from the PC Engine. And I don't know how long it has been that way, but I just noticed that when I was messing with stuff yesterday.
So it could be the cable, even.
It could be. I don't know. I don't know. That will need to be troubleshot.
Yeah.
Is that a word? Is that how you say it? is that the correct form of troubleshoot to use? It will be troubleshot.
The moral of the story is that it never is over.
The past tense of troubleshooting is troubleshot. Yeah. But you're right, it's never over.
It's always
we can never reach troubleshot. Troubleshot will never be achieved.
Yeah. Never ends. Never ends. Just when you think you got something, it's like this is the best it's gonna be. It's either you think of an idea of like something you'd like to do, or something will stop working right. It's just the way it is.
Yeah, I need to figure that out, but I mean obviously that's not there's pretty much no way that's a problem with the broader setup as a whole. That's just a specific system-specific issue. But yeah, but for some reason it seems things are working fine. G-Scart to Extron to Framemeister. But they weren't working G-Scart to Extron to OSSC. Until I turned... I think it still didn't work going through the Extron if I turned sync stripping off on the G-Scart when the OSSC was in its old position. But now going directly from the G-Scart to OSSC... Yeah. It's working.
Kelsey, you're a big fan of the Wonder Swan. Didn't you say it's like your favorite system or something, isn't it?
It's my favorite weird system. Like it doesn't
I get that.
Like it's not like I play my Wonder Swan more than I play, you know, my modern consoles and stuff. but it's definitely my favorite like kind of niche weird system.
There's a million different variants of it, isn't there?
It's like as many colors as there are games, honestly. I'm actually going for a full set now. I'm not like a full set person. I'm not trying to collect all the games for anything other than that. Mm-hmm. But WonderSwan's only about between WonderSwan and WonderSwan Color, it's not a whole lot more than 200 games. And there's two really expensive ones, and then everything else is pretty reasonable, honestly, for now. So
kinda like the 3DO. The 3DO has like one really expensive game on it. But that one game is like really expensive. I can't think of what it's called.
What?
Got a couple of my Wonder Swans here. Hold on. Let's see. I like some of the. So these are just like regular Wonder Swans. These this like green and kind of bluish green one. But I like these a lot because of the color name. This is Melon Soda, and this is Mint Sorbet. I really like those names.
Yeah, so, it's great.
Can you like hold it like vertically?
Yeah.
Like what's the double D-pad for?
Yeah, not enough games utilize it like this, but yeah, some games are vertical instead of horizontal, which is really cool. Would have been amazing if there were like a lot of vertical shmups on the system, but there's like one, so so it sucks cuz yeah, it's something that it does really well and just no one really did anything with that.
I mean, it just seems perfect. Now what
is the nice one. If you get a Wonder Swan, you should really get the crystal. It's the most expensive of course, but it's got the nicest screen, plays both you know, the regular Wonder Swan and the Wonder Swan Color game, so.
And none of the screens are lit, is that right?
Mm-mm. The crystal one's like still a really good screen though.
Yeah, would you compare it to like a Game Boy Color screen? Because it's like that's a pretty good screen for an unlit screen.
Yeah, it's better. It's definitely better than like a regular Game Boy Advance.
Right.
You can see it pretty well even when you're not like in correct lighting. Mm-hmm. But I mean, yeah, obviously it would be better if it was lit.
Yeah.
Do any mods exist for it?
I haven't seen any TV out or capture mod for the Wonder Swan. I think pretty much all Wonder Swan footage just has to be captured through emulators, or I guess so. I've got the Wonder Witch, which
someone
is
someone needs to get on that. Hopefully,
that's the like dev kit. Basically, it's a consumer dev kit, so like anyone could purchase it, kind of like at Eurose. But it's that you can play. You can like develop and play WonderSwan games through that. But you need like an older PC because it, first of all, has a serial port out into the. So already you need an older PC, and then I think the oldest Windows it runs on is like XP or something like that.
How would you classify the WonderSwan library? Because like the first thing I think of is like it got like the Final Fantasy ports, it was kind of a big deal because they was going to get like the first port of Final Fantasy III, and then like it would have been the only 2D conversion of that game, I believe, and they never released it. That's what I always think of. But how would you classify the WonderSwan library as a whole? Because that, like, I just think of Final Fantasy on like what.
Yeah, they had.
Force of Gates is it really known for or good at?
They had a lot of Square did a lot of games for them, so published a lot of games on the WonderSwan. So there's definitely a lot of RPGs. There's a pretty good amount of like puzzle games. Honestly, it's kind of all over the place. Like it's good. There's rhythm games. There's puzzle games. There's platformers. There's action games. But I would say probably the majority are RPGs.
What would you say would be like the top 2 to 3 games for the system that you think people here?
You've been thinking about getting one.
Who couldn't read Japanese? Like what would be the best games to recommend?
Sure, my favorite that's actually a WonderSwan exclusive is called Rhyme Rider Karorikon. I can spell that in the chat real quick because there you go. So that is made by the same people who did Rib Ribbon.
So
it's really similar. It's like a rhythm game that is, you're also like kind of going through a level at the same time. You'll have to press certain buttons rather than like it telling you press X or whatever. You press the correct things when you encounter the correct obstacle. So if you encounter this certain enemy, you have to do like a, you know, press one button to do like this move or to do a punch or to jump or whatever. That game is really awesome. I do recommend getting it complete just because you won't really be able to figure it out without the manual, unfortunately. But let's see, beyond that, there's some good, there's a Makaimura, like
Ghosts
and Goblins. Yeah,
for the an original one. Cool.
Yeah.
Really?
Like no port of it anywhere
also...
else.
Interesting.
What?
No port of it, like anywhere else?
Oh, no. I'm sorry. I'm pretty sure it's the same as. I'm pretty sure it's a port of. Gosh, I don't even know. Maybe the Famicom one. I'm not entirely.
So the first one, because that would make sense. It was like,
I'm sorry, I misunderstood your question. but there's also Klonoa. Same Klonoa as was released on the Game Boy Advance, except that it's only black and white, and there's some differences, but it's mostly the same game.
Interesting.
There's a Ninja Jajamaru game, which is fun if you're familiar with that Famicom series.
Somewhat. I think if it's is that. I'm pretty positive I played one of those. That's not the Ninja Kid one, or is it?
No, it's like an arcadey type thing. Like you're in a level that's got multiple platforms, and there'll be enemies coming at you, and you gotta.
And there's like a different objective. Like every time you go in the level, it's like collect this many things or kill this many of these enemies. I think.
Yeah.
I played one of those.
There's a bunch of them in Japan, and I can't remember if we've ever gotten a Ninja Jajamaru here. We might have, but I'm trying to remember. The other, let's see, what else? There's a lot of really cool games.
Super chat. Gunpei
is like the puzzle game that everyone should play because it's like $7 and it's a pretty fun little puzzle game. There's also another puzzle game that I really like called Engacho. That one's also on the Japanese PS1, but it didn't come out anywhere else other than those two things, to my knowledge. So Engacho is a puzzle game in which you're kind of like on a grid similar to like, you know, if you're playing a tactics game or something, and there's enemies on the grid, and when you move, they move in tandem with you. So, like, they'll either... in the first level, like, it'll just move, you know, if you move to the left, it'll move to the left, or if you move to the right, it'll move to the right. But eventually you'll have some that, like, when you move forward, it will move to the left, or when you move backwards, it'll move three spaces, you know, forwards or something. But it's always related to what you do. So that those ones are pretty fun. And there's lots of other ports, you know, Puzzle Bobble and Puyo Puyo and, you know.
Gotta have Puyo Puyo.
Yeah. There's also a One Piece fighting game that's pretty good. It's like a similar, it's like one of those kind of similar to like a Super Smash Brothers style, you know, there's like platforms and stuff. Whoops, Dr. Wonder's fun.
Trey, you've been thinking about getting one, haven't you?
Yeah, I mean, sort of. Like, I mean, it's just like, you know, I've been saying, like, the last, like, kind of priority that I have for, like, hardware that I don't own is, like, a Game Gear. Like, I want a consolized Game Gear.
Uh-oh, you don't want to tell Voltar about that.
I'm sure that that probably won't be like the last retro thing that I buy. So I'm probably going to like at some point come up with some reason to get something else. I don't know why, like a Swan Crystal comes to mind. Like it's like, oh, like I don't know, there are Final Fantasy games on it. But yeah, I mean, I don't like to have necessarily pressing me, but it's just, I don't know, there's just something interesting about the system. It looks interesting. It's kind of one of those oddities that's just, I don't know, I'm curious about it. I'm sure I could find games I like on, but for now Game Gear is my priority. But
I don't know if you guys noticed, but this game is awesome.
Yeah, like, is it I was kind of under the impression it was sort of more of like a high score, like arena.
Well,
it
definitely
sort
has
of
progression, but it's in
bosses. But it's like, it looks to me like there's like levels that you go through. Like, they're like a, like, cause like, you know, they made this, the guys that made Rezogun, and I.
Well, they had progression too. I mean, that.
Did it really? Like, it didn't feel like.
No, I had. It was.
I mean, that wasn't really my kind of game. Like, I feel like if I had watched you play this before the limited run was available, I probably would have bought it. I mean, it does look like, yeah, it's got progression. Like, I saw you fight bosses and stuff. Like, it's definitely much more my kind of game than I thought it was going to be.
Yeah,
the game looks cool.
It's definitely pretty cool, but it's also like I'm playing it on rookie because I had no idea what to expect, kind of going in. I mean, it's very rare that I'll buy like any of limited run games that are I don't really know what they're about. I guess like I'll kind of do a quick look at them before they're. If I've never like seen him in action, I'll just kind of
the first word you need to look for is it procedural generation? Okay, I'm not gonna look up anything more. For both of us, that's like
we were just talking about
generation.
Yesterday. Like the two things that will make it so that I do not want a game is procedural generation and user created levels.
Yeah, you kind of cut out there. I know what you said, but say it again.
Procedurally generated levels, and user created content. Like you're talking about that Dreams game, like about how like it doesn't really interest me at all. You know, just like user created levels. Like it's very focused on that kind of stuff.
Like Little Big Planet
was good, but that was
it had a decent campaign.
Yes. But I mean
especially the second game. But Once it got to the point of like, oh, I'm going, like, I don't, like, I really respect the people who, like, make, like, all the content for in those sorts of games and, like, they're way into it. And, like, I wish I had the time to put into it, but, like, I'm just, like, in such a state where it's, like, if it's beyond the scope of what the creators put into the game.
What currency is PLN?
PLN?
Yeah, I have no idea what PLN is.
Portuguese somethings?
I don't know.
That's my wild guess. Let's see if I'm right. I'm going to Google it. What?
It's Polish.
Oh.
Polish. Help us pronounce this. Zloty? Zloty?
Polish Zloty. Zloty? There's like a cross through the L.
Can someone make a phonetic pronunciation of that for me?
What does Wikipedia say? Ooh, I can listen. Let's listen. Zwalte. It says, the Wikipedia thing says, let me listen again. Zwalte. Zwalte.
I gotta use the dodge more.
Zwalte. That sounds cool.
It does.
I never heard of that one. Thank you.
For those that don't know, we got a pretty cool mention by a YouTuber by the name of Jeremy Johns. J-A-H-N.
Jimmy Johns?
Yeah.
Yeah, we got a lot of new subscribers, so there might be some new folks here tonight.
Yeah, yeah. He is a movie reviewer and gave us a pretty extensive shout out in one of his videos. And he has 1.3 million subscribers.
Congratulations.
Yeah, it's kind of surreal. It was so cool to hear that. You know, it was like it was Friday, I think it was, around like 10:30. I was out with my son. We were getting him a haircut, and I looked at just checked in the subscribers, and I was like, wait, have we gotten 256 subscribers today? Like that doesn't happen. Like usually, like our daily average is like 50. And we end up getting like over 1,000 subscribers that day, meaning that we're gonna cross the 80,000 subscriber. It was kind of our goal for the year. We weren't sure if it was gonna happen.
Because... you're what, like 90 away, and you got 21 days left.
I know, but before this happened, we had like over 2,000 to go.
So, oh wow! Okay.
So we weren't cool. sure if it was gonna happen or not.
I think you guys will hit it. That's awesome.
Yeah, I mean, like, we're definitely going to hit it now, but at the time, there was a point where
it was very uncertain. It would have been a stretch.
Yeah.
I see Game Dave in the chat. Seems surprised to see me wearing pants, by which I assume he means blue jeans. And the reason is because, you know, normally I wear comfy pants at home. Which, you know, not that jeans are uncomfy, but I like to go a touch comfier when at home.
Yeah.
Shorts in the summer.
I spend a lot of my time at home in pajama pants, but, you know, like...
Sweatpants.
I'm not trying to impress anybody.
or thinner comfy pants, you know, in the winter, but long pants. But the reason I've been working on my setup, like, I've been fighting a cold, like, I'm finally over it today, but, like, I've been fighting a cold all week and working on my setup. But so I was working on my setup all week, and, like, in the wintertime, I am, like, constantly staticky.
It's a problem.
It's a problem. Like, I feel like it didn't used to be this way, but, like, for like, the past decade, like, in winter, like, I'm not even, like, there was a point in time where, like, you get a little static shock, and it's like, ooh, now it's just like, okay, where's something metal that I can discharge myself? I mean, it's like, Like, I literally walk like 2 feet and like I can touch the screw on a light switch and you know, get rid of my shack. So I've been working on my setup a ton. So like jeans make me less staticky than other wintertime pants. So that's why I'm wearing jeans.
There's nothing, you know, it makes sense.
But I actually kind of had a little scare with the OSSC yesterday. Because, you know, you got to be careful with sort of these, like, open... I don't even know what the term for it really is. But these, like, open shell electronics that, you know, sort of these more homebrew type things. Like the G-SCART and the OSSC. They don't have, like, a complete enclosure. And, more detailed than he expected. There are reasons behind these pants, Dan. Yeah. I've contemplated these reasons deeply, and I want you to know. But anyway, so I was working with the OSSC, you know, testing out my PC engine and other things, as I mentioned earlier. And I guess I wasn't being quite careful. I felt a little shock when I was touching the environs of the OSSC. And there was, like, along the top of the LCD screen, there was, like, a filled-in row of pixels and, like, a little bit of shading around the top right corners. And it went away after, like, a minute or so. But, like I guess that shock did that. And, like, I'm just lucky it was, like, not shocking something. But I honestly, like, as staticky as I can be,
What if you'd like killed the, after all that money, all that money, and then you kill the thing?
And it's like, got the OSSC 1.6 working flawlessly with my setup. I zap it,
and then you like kill it, plugging in some cables into it. I mean, like, I'm not saying that it would be funny, but it'd be.
It'd be funny in a sense of the word, I guess.
Right.
But yeah, so it was, you know, that was like, uh-oh. But I can't believe I've never, like, destroyed anything with static electricity, because I'm just, like, constantly, like, by this time of year, it's just, like, constant.
Yeah.
Too many sweaters.
I don't even wear sweaters anymore.
Kelsey, have you really? Like ever gotten anything in the store, in your store, and then like it like break before you could sell it? It was expensive.
Before I can sell it?
Yeah, like for some, or like, you know, yeah, something expensive, and then suddenly, because I
not super expensive, but one time, this is a long time ago, like when I first started working for my company now. Someone traded in a Master System, and they had with it the wrong power supply. I did not notice it was the wrong power supply fit in there. So I turned it on, and I like walk over to the other side of the store to do something else, and I start smelling smoke.
Oh.
And so I walk over there, and the Master System is literally smoking. There is black smoke pouring out of it.
Oh, no.
So I immediately turn it off, and I just like, just set the thing like outside. I'm like, I don't know what to do. I killed the Master System one time, not paying attention.
I wonder what kind of power supply it was, because, like...
It was one of those that had, like, a switch on it. So, dude. Yeah, so you could, like, change the voltage. And, dude. Yeah, and I had it set to the wrong one, I guess. I was not paying attention.
I heard a pretty good story, like, about something, like, getting killed like that. There's a local game store around me called Arcade Legacy, and it's like has an arcade in there as well as a retro game store, and it's in like this kind of abandoned mall, and there's a parking garage, and they like just spent all this money on this one specific game that they were going to put in the arcade. I cannot remember what game it was, but it was an expensive game, and he had it in the back of the guy who was selling it to them, like, had it in the back of his, like, flatbed truck, and then he drove into the parking garage at the mall, but it was too low, and it, like, cut the thing in half.
Oh, no!
Oh,
I wonder, Like, is there any reason that you couldn't just transport it, like, horizontally?
Oh, yeah, I'm sure. But I just, like, I think that he just, like, had it in there, and it, like, it cut it in half, I guess.
Oof.
I mean, it's like, not funny, but...
Again, like, if someone had caught that on film, though, it would be kind of funny.
Yeah.
That'd be like a huge YouTube viral video.
Oh, we got Jimmy Hoppa in the chat. Kelsey, you're a fan of, oh, is he? That's
yeah, I know.
He did a really good interview with Retro RGB.
Yeah, I watched it. Was that the one where he showed his face?
Yeah, he did the big face reveal. And we didn't even know that.
I watched it for like 10 seconds just to see his face. And I'm like, okay, I'm going to come back to actually watch this. But I got to see his face. I don't know why you hide your face, dude. Well, I assumed you were like ugly because you never showed your face.
Dude. So you're a big fan of Jimmy. Like you watch this stuff for a while.
Yeah, he makes great content. Absolutely. If you're interested in import gaming, or you think you could be interested in import gaming, you should watch his stuff. Yeah. They're long videos, though.
Yeah, but he's like just listen to him talk. He's very, very quick witted, and funny.
Yeah. Yeah. He does not get enough credit. That's for sure.
Yeah. I'm just trying to finish this level, and once I finish this level, we can wrap it up here. I don't want to lose my progress. I think I'm going to fight the boss.
Yeah, I am at least somewhat regretting not getting this. It looks amazing.
Well, I'm sure they have, like, if you're at a convention that they are at, then you can maybe get
them. Yeah, they'll probably have some extras.
If we see them again in the future.
I'll have extras at the store.
Oh, there you go. Do you ever sell stuff that you would get into the store, like, on eBay? Do you have, like, an eBay store as well?
Occasionally. It's really only if it's something that's been sitting for like so long and sat through so many conventions, or a lot of times we'll sell like PAL stuff online because the amount of people shopping for PAL stuff is like non-existent. Right. So especially when it comes to like the retro stuff, that's more difficult to get around, you know,
or if it's like a copy of Terranigma, which is in English, like an official copy in English.
Maybe you can talk Reggie into taking your PAL stuff. It sounded like, I don't know if it was like more like newer PAL stuff or older PAL stuff. He was talking about being interested in PAL stuff last week.
The problem is when we get that stuff in, it's not anything. It's not like interesting. Oh. You know, PAL exclusive stuff. It's just like a copy of, I don't know, just like Wipeout or something, but the PAL version. Mm. So, you know, the game that's not worth very much money and came out everywhere.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah, there was a copy of Ninja Gaiden Shadow, a PAL version of that at on my local stores for a long time, and I think they call it Shadow Warriors or something like that instead. It's like not like, I guess like Europe had something against ninjas for a long time. Ninjas were bad. Teenage Mutant Hero Turtles and all but yeah, the PAL version of Ninja Gaiden Shadow, I think it's called Shadow Warriors or something like that. And it was like just sitting there for a long time, and I have like the American version of Ninja Gaiden Shadow, which is a very good game. I asked him, do you know what this is, by the way? Because this game might be a little more interesting if you could explain to people like, oh, like this is a less expensive version of. I mean, it's not like a really expensive game, but it's a little expensive for a Game Boy game.
And there's like no difference besides the name, pretty much.
No, I mean like 50 hertz isn't a thing in the world of Game Boy. Like you don't right. have to worry about PAL versions. I've got a couple of PAL versions or PAL exclusives. I've got two PAL exclusive Game Boy games.
I have some PAL DS games and PSP games.
Which I don't even know if it's like really, it's probably not really correct to say PAL versions right. when it's like not connected to a PAL TV, but it's PAL region. So, it's, you know, it's the easiest to say way to say
like,
it.
Than like, you know, Europe and also some other like,
yeah, you know, yeah,
to just
yeah.
like list all of the countries that it's sold in.
What are the, what PSP games?
The Tales of, is it Tales of Eternia? Tales of one of the
oh yeah yeah yeah, and probably was, Breath of Fire 3.
Japan, the only English version is on European PSP.
That's
so
right. That's right.
Have that. There's also like a Puyo Puyo game that I think only came out in Europe mm-hmm. on the PSP.
And Breath of Fire 3, which is like the one I have.
Yeah, so, yeah, I've got that one as well.
Before and then yeah. they ended up releasing that in the US, but it's digital only.
Right.
I guess I can.
Yeah, Europe got a
kind of a dick thing. I got
Adventures of Flolo game for the Game Boy, which Japan got it too. It's just called Adventures of Flolo. I forget if the Japanese version has another name, but the Japanese version is more expensive than the European version. But the European version has like at least twice as much content, I want to say. Like, they like at least double the number of levels. It's also really hard. I feel like it's harder than the NES Lolo games. But yeah, it's interesting. It like never, like a friend of mine in England was like, hey, I just saw this pop up on French eBay. It like never crops up. Because he knew I was a big fan of the Lolo games, and like it's like not even crazy expensive or anything. I mean, it's a little expensive, but it's not like hundreds of dollars. It's like $30 to $40, but it just never appears. So I got that, and I also got Game Boy Gallery, which is like before Game & Watch Gallery. Like, I don't even think this is in Japan. I think this is only in Europe, maybe Australia. It's was made before Game & Watch Gallery, and it has
he has a retro mode, a fairly bad looking retro mode, but it's a it's like a widescreen CRT.
Oh.
Weird. You know, maybe it's trying to look like a arcade game,
but anyway, it's like the modern versions in the Game & Watch Gallery games. Except it doesn't have Mario characters, just like these weird, like, some of them kind of look like puppets. Like, it's just sort of weird, generic-looking characters. But it's like the precursor to Game & Watch Gallery, and it's PAL region exclusive for some reason.
There's also a graphics filter, and it's called Darker and Edgier.
It looks too darker.
What?
It looks too much darker.
Yeah. Grayscale, that's kind of cool though. It's cool that they have those in here.
Grayscale seems difficult.
Yeah.
Like it would be just hard to tell what's going on.
It is co-op though. Local co-op.
Yeah, you know, next time I see Douglas at a convention, I'm gonna be like,
hey,
got any copies of that? I can't remember what it's called right now, but I want it. What's it called? Nex Machina?
Yeah. Nex Machina Death Machine. I didn't realize there was a subtitle for it called Death Machine. Well, is that gonna wrap us up?
I guess so.
Cool.
I'm working on an episode. Hopefully it will be out this week. I have a lot of stuff kind of happening right now. I have like a freelance job and we have like some other stuff going on. I was out of town. I was at my in-laws this weekend, so I didn't get to work on it. Hopefully it should be out. It's going to be about a 12-minute episode. Tries working on something. Hopefully we'll, if we're lucky, we'll have three episodes up for the end of the year. Probably not though. Yours is what?
I said mine's probably going to be shorter than yours, or at least I hope it is.
Yeah, I mean, it could be. But I mean, we could have three episodes out before the end of the year.
Yeah.
I mean, it's very
possible. There might be, I don't know for sure when it's going to release. I'm not going to say what it is, but there might be a really cool video on another YouTube channel that I'll appear in.
Oh, yeah.
Either this week or the next week.
Yeah, you shot something for that today, I think.
Yep.
It might relate to something that's appeared on our channel recently. Maybe. In a weird way. In a way, like, I don't, like, I mean, it relates in a way that, you know, you
wouldn't expect.
Yeah, I guess.
It's a game I am passionate about. Yeah.
Something so, you've wanted to do, like, a video on for a long time, but
yeah,
probably after this comes out, better
than this video. Yeah, I mean, I'm not going to say anything, but there is some really cool stuff in this.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I'm really excited to see how it turns out.
Yeah. Kelsey, do you have anything coming up that you want to get people?
Nothing that's coming up like super soon, but hopefully in the next, I would say 7 to 10 days. I still got quite a bit of work to do on it, but I'm working on it.
by my time scale, that's pretty super soon.
Yeah.
By the time it's like 7 to 10 days away, I'm like, I think I see the light at the end of the tunnel.
Maybe, yeah. You're working full time. I mean, you can't, like, it's,
yeah,
for stuff than, it's just like hard to find the time to do it sometimes, and sometimes you probably get home and you're just like, I can't even do it.
Yeah,
especially this time of year, it's got to be crazy for you this time of year.
It's very crazy this time of year. And there's some other stuff I'm working on too outside of work, like volunteer type stuff. I'm working on a grant right now, actually, which is new for me.
Where is that, like, when they, like, kind of give you money to do something?
They're like a study
or something like that.
Independent bodies that have money, sometimes government funded, sometimes independently, you know, foundations funded. This one's for the Video Game History Foundation, so we're trying to get some money to develop stuff.
Is that Frank Cifaldi's thing?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, cool. Yeah. I mean, he's part of Digital Eclipse, who just announced that they're doing the Street Fighter collection today. Isn't he part of Digital Eclipse?
I don't know that he's working on that.
Okay. Because I know...
He's definitely done... Yeah, like, he's been on basically all of those, but I don't think he's... I think he's just full-time with the foundation now. I don't think he's working on anything else.
Oh, okay. I mean, he definitely worked on the... not the Disney collection, but the first Mega Man Legacy collection.
Yeah.
Because he did that talk about it. That's cool. That's really cool that you get to be involved with that.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a lot of work right now because it's so new that, you know, it's like no one's getting paid, but
but
I enjoy it, so.
Mm-hmm. Well, all right. Well, thanks for joining us.
For having me on.
Anytime you want to come back, just let us know.
Yeah, I'd be happy to come back. We'll do this again sometime.
All right, everybody.
Well, good night, guys. I know it's late where you are. still some night left for me, but
yeah.
All right. Good night, everyone.
Good night.
Good night.